Welcome to the world of mystery, a world of strange sights and sounds, a world of unexplained mysteries and visitation from other planets. It is a world of ghosts, of monsters from outer space, of demons and sorcery, of monsters from the depths of the seas, of werewolves and satanic ceremonies, of despotic rulers and wars. In short, a world of contradictions, continual conflicts, and unexplained phenomena which scientists are only now beginning to unravel. In the vast reaches of space, the mysteries which have baffled the ages lie waiting to be explored. How long must man wait to learn the secrets of the universe? How long must man wait to understand the mysterious world about him? It is only in this century that man has begun to strip away the clouds of deception which surround the world of fantastic phenomena and unexplained mysteries now confronting man. For somewhere out in space is the key to this astounding mystery, the key to lost civilizations, to undersea kingdoms, to mythical monsters and haunted houses, to systems of astrological divination and biblical prognostication, to the thousands of unexplained incidents which have been recorded down through the years of man's history, both in fantastic legends and often in even more astounding true life stories. Come with us then on an astounding voyage through man's past and into man's often terrifying future. Do UFOs exist? Are we being visited by creatures from other planets? What about the Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, reports of ghostly visitations and horrifying monsters, lost civilizations and the kingdom of Atlantis? Is there any truth at all to reports of invaders from outer space, of messages in the stars, of worlds far from Earth where civilizations exist which are very unlike our own? In the vast reaches of space, there are thousands of unexplained mysteries and phenomena which man still struggles to understand, and a million and one secrets waiting to be uncovered. We still know so little about our own planet, and we are in the very dawn of the nuclear age. Recent incidents at nuclear power plants on our East Coast indicate that man still has a long way to go before he can control the awesome forces of the atom. And in the world of outer space, man has only reached the moon and looks longingly out from its barren surface to the stars in the surrounding universe. Man may reach Mars by the end of the 1980s, but even that gigantic distance is but a small step in the amazing, ever-expanding universe we live in. Who is out there in the vast blackness of space? What do they want? Are they our friends or enemies? Will we be invaded by civilizations from outer space? Are reports of UFOs in our skies to be believed, or are they mostly hoaxes and the rest easily explained away as weather phenomena or refraction of light? We still know so little of the world about us. In the next 2 hours, we will take you with us on a journey beyond the stars in an effort to find out the truth behind the astounding reports which have baffled our best scientists for decades. Explore with us, then, the amazing world of mystery. This ceremony takes place on the night of the full moon, or witch's Sabbath, and can transform a man into a horrifying creature of the night, a werewolf bent on drinking human blood. This man is involved in a voodoo ceremony. He hopes will bring back the ghost of his dead wife so that he may commune with her. Such ceremonies and beliefs are common throughout the islands of the South Seas and in Jamaica and Haiti. Here a voodoo priestess, a mambo, possessed by the ocean god Agwe, has fallen into a trance as part of a voodoo ceremony. Supported by her followers, she will commune with the god in an attempt to bring rain to the parched crops of her island home. These are mummified remains of two of the devil people of Haiti, supposedly discovered in 1740, showing Tlahuchu and his devil bride in their final resting place. The bones have been x-rayed and found to be human. Note the horns. A voodoo drum ceremony in Haiti leads to a trance-like state of possession for this young follower, who thrashes about wildly in possession of the snake god, Dambala. Voodoo ceremonies can last 10 hours and more. Seen in this photograph is the creator of Sherlock Holmes, Arthur Conan Doyle, supposedly surrounded by tiny fairies. Actually, this photo is a fake, constructed to show that fakery was possible. This photo of a medieval tapestry shows a seven-headed dragon, which is known in the Book of Revelations as the Beast of the Apocalypse. Here, the beast menaces the earth after being cast out of heaven. The Komodo dragon lizard is the closest actual cousin to the seven-headed dragon of biblical legend. These lizards have been measured at up to 9 feet long. Man's imagination has always been captured by tales of mermaids, and here a pretty denizen of the sea snags an unwary sailor for her lover. This drawing of a mermaid done in 1717 was supposedly drawn from life by a sailor who saw the mermaid while sailing on his ship in the South Seas. The manatee, however, is probably the model for all such sightings of mermaids. As far as we know, mermaids do not really exist. It is possible that this creature has inspired many such sightings. Here we have the famous fake sea monster of 1897, supposedly captured off the coast of England. Though amusing, this picture is obviously a hoax. These frightening fish are the grotesque hatchet fish, each only 3 inches long. But who knows what monstrous cousins it may have in the inky depths of the ocean. This is, of course, a photo of the famous Loch Ness Monster, taken in 1934. It was photographed by a London doctor on vacation and is regarded as authentic by most impartial observers. A view of Loch Ness taken in 1969, with the monster, affectionately known as Nessie, clearly visible in the center of the picture. This photo, too, is thought to be genuine. The notorious Aleister Crowley is shown here, involved in a demonic ceremony. Crowley was often called the most evil man alive and presided over countless black magic ceremonies. Psychic Uri Gellar has recently come to the forefront of the news media with his amazing feats of psychokinetic control and prognostication. Here, Uri bends a spoon through sheer willpower and concentration. Although some dismiss his feats as showmanship, the vast majority of observers feel that Gellar is a genuine psychic. Indian holy men going to the Ganges River to bathe. These holy men take part in this ceremony only once every 6 years. These sadhus spend countless hours attempting to discover the secrets of the universe. These are photos of a man actually walking over hot coals in India. The man walked over coals heated to over 800 degrees Fahrenheit and emerged without injury. The famous Austrian doctor and psychic Franz Anton Mesmer discovered hypnosis and mesmerism in the 1800s. Here we see Mesmer treating a patient. This is an engraving of an angel invoked by a medieval holy man. The angel appears in a circle of light, brandishing the staff of heaven in his hand. From the realm of superstition and witchcraft, we now journey to the world of science fact. Here, a group of schoolchildren are ushered through NASA headquarters. These children will be the space explorers of tomorrow as they journey through space to learn the secrets of the universe. Our government spends many millions of dollars annually on space research, engaging thousands of scientists in our race for the stars. For our government knows, whoever controls the heavens controls the universe. Our government is not the only world power interested in the possible uses of space for both peace and war, and the struggle to control the solar system goes on and on. And all this research leads to one thing: man's first uncertain steps into the unknown. Alone in space, man must rely on his life support systems of oxygen and radio communication with the Earth to guide him through the vast, uncharted reaches of space. Sets foot on the moon. But it is really just the beginning of the exploration of the universe. This small step for mankind will be but the first chapter in the history of space exploration. We have claimed the moon for ourselves, but what right do we have other than our own word for it? Do we really own the moon? Or is it the domain of a hidden race which watched our faltering steps onto their planet with amusement and dismay? And what of the inner world we are just now beginning to explore with the aid of the electron microscope? Is it not possible that man is just a small speck in the vast design of things? That the Earth is merely a small grain of sand in the vastness of the universe? Maybe other civilizations regard us as we regard a single-celled amoeba or a carbon atom. And then, of course, there is the world of DNA structures and cloning, which reproduces life itself in the laboratory. Here man is embarking on what may be his most astounding voyage of discovery yet. Leaving NASA's laboratories, we climb high into the clouds. We are aboard a weather search plane, which scans the heavens for news of impending storms and disasters. Aboard the aircraft, precision instruments watch the skies, revealing the cataclysms of nature before they happen. Every day, these planes embark from NASA headquarters, bound on a mission to uncover hurricanes, tornadoes, and other weather phenomena before they strike. Additionally, these planes scan the heavens for proof of UFOs. Flying over the world, the plane takes photographs which will be converted into maps for use by the Meteorological Service of the U.S. Weather Bureau and used by forecasters around the country in predicting the weather for their particular area. Without these photo maps, man would be at the complete mercy of the elements, not knowing whether tomorrow would bring sunshine or a devastating holocaust of wind and destruction. Back on Earth, this information is relayed to waiting computers, which design the maps for use by weathermen around the globe. Processing information at the speed of light, these computers are an important link in man's plan to understand the universe's secrets. Here we show you a collection of astounding UFO photos from around the world. This UFO was seen over the New Mexico desert. All analysis of the photo points to the fact that it is a real UFO sighting. This UFO was sighted in the Middle East in the mid-60s. It too has been exhaustively examined and proven to be a genuine UFO encounter. This UFO was seen over Balotic, Yugoslavia in 1978. It was shown to UFO organizations around the world, who reported seeing this type of UFO in other sightings as well. This is a Japanese UFO sighting, showing two UFOs in flight over the Earth. There is some speculation that this photo may have been retouched. This UFO sighting took place in Denmark in 1974. Again, this sighting has been subjected to exhaustive tests by respected UFO authorities and pronounced genuine. These UFO sightings were taken in rural Pennsylvania by a farmer and amateur photographer. They were taken only seconds apart. In the first photo, the UFO heads straight for the photographer, while in the second photo, the UFO flies away into the distance. These photos caused a great deal of comment when screened by the nation's top UFO experts. A newspaper publisher took this photo of a UFO in 1973 near Pelham, Georgia. This photo was shown around the U.S. at UFO conferences and has been called a genuine UFO sighting. Only a few weeks later, this photo was taken near the site of the first UFO sighting, as the UFO hovered over the ground at a height of about 9,000 feet. Finally, a TV news crew took this film of a UFO in the same area as both of the previous sightings on September 9, 1973. This photo was accompanied by the sworn testimony of the photographer and his crew and is considered a genuine UFO picture. When one considers the hundreds of UFO sightings reported each year, one must inevitably ask the question, is there life on other worlds? Do civilizations exist on planets far from our own? Is there a welcome waiting for us in outer space? Or is man all alone in the universe? Life on other planets could have had a volcanic genesis, being created out of the smoke, fire, and brimstone of an erupting formative volcano. In the dawning days of our own planet, these volcanic eruptions shaped the rock structure and carved the river valleys of our world. Of course, no life as we know it could live under such conditions. But what of life as we do not know it? It is entirely possible that on volcanic worlds far from our own, life has adapted to these conditions and is flourishing. Rock people, perhaps, formed from molten lava. Is anything too impossible in this astounding world of ours? And gradually, as the ocean spilled over into the volcanic ash, the world cooled and took on new form. No longer did the volcanic eruptions hold sway over the planet's surface. Now, the new order of the sea took dominion over the forming planet. And again, what sort of life might exist here in the volcanic sea-washed bosom of an emerging planet? Looking out over the landscape, one can imagine all sorts of monsters and creatures taking shape in the primordial slime and volcanic lava flow. And this process is constantly continuing throughout the universe, as worlds we do not even know the existence of continue to be born and die, living out their entire lifespan without our even knowing it. Our own galaxy is but a pinprick in the vast expanse of the universe. Who can say what planets, what worlds, and what life forms and civilizations await our visits beyond the stars and planets of our own limited imaginations? And as the volcanic lava was cooled by the waters, the planet settled into a new stage, one of vast desert stretches, waiting for new life to begin. It would seem that this inhospitable surface could not possibly nurture any life form. But what of underground civilizations toiling away beneath the surface of the planet? They would not ever have to come to the surface at all, having all their sources of light and food well beneath the barren surface of the planet. As one explores the surface of such a planet, it would seem best to tread lightly. One never knows what one might come across. H.G. Wells, in his first Men in the Moon, posed the existence of a race of moon men living beneath the surface of the planet, driven underground by war and famine, as well as changing atmospheric conditions. Contemplating this story, one might wonder about the future of our own planet. If we cannot learn to control our nuclear technology, man may have to learn to live underground as well in the post-nuclear Holocaust future. Are these furrows and ridges traces of a lost civilization? One that perished in the last days of war or natural disaster? Or is this planet in the beginning days of its lifespan, searching for its own future in blind, groping, uncertain steps? As we trace our own history, we see that we can never be sure whether this volcanic stage is a beginning or an ending. In the next step of evolution, the planet's cooling produces ice caps, which potential civilizations might harness to use as irrigation for crops. These ice caps are seen most prominently on our own planet and on Mars, where the seasons are marked by the melting and reforming of the ice caps at both poles of the planet. There has been much speculation that the canals of Mars are actually irrigation ditches, which water the whole planet for Martian farmers. Whether this is true or not, we cannot say. And on Venus, for example, the entire surface of the planet is covered with gases of indeterminate origin. What is happening underneath the layer of these noxious fumes? And what strange forms of life might exist in an atmosphere of poison gas and extreme cold or heat? We must remember that life on our Earth is no yardstick by which to judge the possibility of life on other planets. The clouds of Venus might hide a swampy vegetation, where many tentacled life forms swim silently about in the black depths of the planet's waters, searching for food and waiting, silently waiting for the first alien explorers. Who can tell what forms of life might exist on a planet which we cannot even see, obscured underneath a layer of such gases? It will be decades before man reaches Venus, unless Venus reaches us first. The planet is still waiting, patiently waiting for life to be born. What form will it take? What will it look like? How will it survive? The forbidding landscape is whipped by desert winds, winds which make our own Sahara Desert look like a stretch of beach along the sea. Here, temperatures soar into the thousands of degrees and then drop into thousands of degrees below zero. It is quite possible that somehow, some way, something has found a way to survive on the surface of a planet which man cannot hope to exist on. This object floating high above the Earth, what is it? Is it one of man's observation posts, or is it sent from another planet? It's an observer satellite sending back data which helps us to understand better our own planet and the universe around it. The pictures which this satellite takes helps us to chart our own Earth. The satellite also looks for other things, UFOs, unexplained extraterrestrial phenomena, and the like. Each of these satellites is equipped with hundreds of little lenses which admit light, allowing the satellite to take pictures of the Earth and outer space. Precision crafted, these lenses will not malfunction in deep space, where repairs would be costly, if not impossible. If one lens does malfunction, the others will permit the satellite to continue to monitor the heavens. The satellite takes pictures, then bounces them back to waiting computers on Earth. These computers then design maps, which may be used to predict Earth conditions for many months ahead. Throughout the world, at hundreds of remote outposts, scientists keep watch on these sentinels of the skies. The information they send back is man's valuable link to the solar system. Without this information, man would truly be at the mercy of the cosmos. Here we see a hurricane as constructed from photos taken by one of these sentinel satellites. Rotating serenely in outer space, the satellite, aided by gigantic dish radar on our planet's surface, constructs amazingly accurate pictures of the fury and destruction of tornadoes and hurricanes. Thermal maps help to define the path of the oncoming hurricane and thus save thousands of lives and prevent millions of dollars of damage. These maps are instantaneously interpreted by a computer, which breaks down the maps into information that can be readily interpreted by scientists. The information is relayed to waiting weather bureaus, which must accurately determine the path of the storm. The inhabitants warned of the coming disaster have time to safely store away all their most precious possessions before the storm hits. Bathtubs are filled with emergency drinking water. Windows are boarded up. People buy emergency foodstuffs. Hospitals are evacuated, and the Red Cross swings into action. Telephone lines are jammed. The Army moves in to help evacuate civilians and stops all traffic coming into the area. Weather flags tell the story. The hurricane is about to hit. Ships rock in the harbor, lashed by wind and waves. Streets and buildings are flooded as a few stragglers are hurried away by civil defense workers. The storm is at its peak. And suddenly, in the violent storm, a new threat. Tornado. A tornado has formed and is heading straight for the center of town. Nothing can stand in the face of a tornado. There is only one thing to do. Evacuate. And here is the aftermath. Destruction. Businesses ruined. Dreams shattered as man tries to pick up the pieces and go on with life. It is not always that easy to do. But here at least, man has been forewarned. Another threat to man is the threat of volcanic eruption. Although this is rare and in many areas seemingly impossible, one must always remember the volcano which gradually grew from a molehill to a mountain in a backyard in Mexico in 1948. The mystery of the creation of volcanoes is still not solved, nor is the mystery of how they may be controlled. Man cannot even tell when they will erupt, and when they do, they inevitably cause millions of dollars of damage and destroy livestock, farms, and often entire cities. Here a tropical volcano has erupted, and the lava pours through the town. Causing forest fires and wreaking havoc, the lava spills over into the sea, causing huge quantities of steam to erupt. And again, the aftermath. Destruction, chaos, loss of life and property. Truly, volcanoes are one of the world's great mysteries, wiping out civilizations in seconds, as they did in the days of Pompeii. No sound, no life is heard. But this lonely sentinel of man's, left in the aftermath of the volcano's destruction, may help man to determine when and if the volcano will erupt again. Yet still the volcano rages on, causing the destruction of thousands of acres of timberland. A scout plane sees the destruction and quickly radios for help. Already firefighters are plowing under the land, creating a ditch and deliberately setting fire to the surrounding underbrush in an attempt to control the fire. Low-flying planes release chemicals which will attempt to put out the fire. It seems as if the fire is at last under control. Now comes a well-deserved rest for the firefighters, until the next time nature mysteriously interrupts their lives. This is all that is left of a small town in Guatemala after an earthquake surprised the inhabitants a little after 3 a.m. on an uneventful spring night. Look about you. Destruction, decay, not a living soul. Where once marble columns proudly stood, now there is only rubble. Proof once again that the stability of man can be easily interrupted at any time. And those who say an earthquake cannot happen in San Francisco or Los Angeles are greatly mistaken. Faults can exist beneath the world's crust for centuries and cause no damage. But suddenly one day, the fault collapses against itself, setting off an earthquake which causes the instantaneous destruction of all in its rage. All the clocks stopped at the same time and there was no way to escape. Yet out in the vast reaches of space, how little this all matters. Man is just a small and not very important part of the vastness of the universe, less than a millionth of its contents. Man thinks he is immortal, but what is age to the denizens of the stars? From a small portion of space, we can grasp the relative insignificance of our own existence. Whether we look at a small portion of the universe or a larger area, we can easily see that mankind could cease to exist without the universe even noticing it. This pointer shows us in relation to the vastness of the universe. We can see that we are nothing more than a speck of light in the vast design of things. What are we to expect from the universe? The universe so awesome and challenging that only now are we beginning to understand the nature of our own existence. Are the other creatures on other planets waiting to be contacted by us? Does life on other planets exist? If we are such a small part of the universe, can we not expect to be treated as such? As life forms so insignificant that our life or death means nothing in the overall scheme of things. Man's history is just a small fraction in the time clock of the universe. It is only in the past 100 years that scientists have begun to chart the history of the planets. Our wars, our hopes, our loves, our dreams, they all seem so unimportant from out here, as our scale pitted against the scale of the endless universe dwindles into nothingness. All human dreams seem so much vanity when placed against the rule of the cosmos, a rule which was existent millions of years before the first primitive life forms appeared on Earth. What will the future of man be? Does someone else have a plan for us? An alien civilization, perhaps? Waiting for us to try to reach them? Or to destroy ourselves in nuclear holocaust before we reach the stars? Man has no guarantee in the universe. Our own internal disasters and natural phenomena assure us that our state is a highly transient one, and that our days on the earth are numbered. We are born, we live, we die. We pass out into the void of the universe, going back into that vast creative mold of space and time which is beyond human comprehension. Searching across the heavens, we look for a brother to help us in our weakness. Is there life like ours? Or only life which regards us as food, as cattle, waiting to swoop down on us and carry us off like so many animals to the slaughterhouse? Space remains silent and forbidding, saying nothing, biding time until the truth finally unfolds. We are just elements, gases, and states of being in the vast world of outer space, and we have no more importance than a flower. We can be destroyed by cosmic rain, by meteors, by comets, by colliding planets. There is no certainty of our future, only of our past and present. We are truly at the mercy of the universe. Somewhere out in space, other planets are waiting to be born, waiting for their turn to unlock the secrets of the universe. These bright balls of gas are planets in their formative state, and we watch their progress with a mixture of fear and anticipation. Will they succeed where we have failed? Will these new planets learn the secrets to rule the universe? Will they be our allies or our enemies? Only time and space know the answers. For the present, we must simply cross our fingers and wait. And if life exists on other worlds, one must ask the inevitable question: is this life friendly to us or hostile? Until we at last learn the secrets of the universe, man will never be able to know for certain. And so the mystery continues, and only man's final leap out into the stars will answer the question: are we alone? And once we know the answer, will they let us alone? Life on other planets take? Simple amoebas? Or more complex forms, such as this creature, shown here ingesting a piece of microscopic food? Will life on other planets be snake-like, shedding its skin at regular intervals? Or hard-shelled, as this turtle is, shown here catching a worm for food? Will life be poisonous, as the tarantula is? Or will life glide gently through the liquids of the planet as this flatworm does? Will there be insect life? Small creatures feeding parasitically off leaves, grasses, and whatever else they can find? Or will life be merely confined to life within life? Or the microscopic life form shown here? In any life scheme, there must be a primary building block for life to exist. On our own planet, these microscopic life forms are the most basic forms of life, short of the single-celled amoeba. While these particular life forms have very little intelligence, who can say that life forms akin to these on other planets might not have intellects far superior to our own? These small, struggling life forms, constantly battling to survive, they fight each other for space, for food, for light, and only the strongest, most adaptable life forms survive. This is true everywhere. The strong multiply, the weak perish. Could it be that comparatively, we are the weaklings of the universe and cannot survive the coming onslaught of an alien civilization? Will man be able to survive in the rapidly changing world about him? Will he be able to adapt to his possible future status as an insignificant minor member of the world community? These small life forms remind us that size is relative, that man must continually prove himself in the vast design of things. Who can say what alien life forms are even now developing, waiting across the void for us to communicate with them? Is man alone in the universe? It would seem presumptuous to think so. And man must understand that he is not the center of the universe. He is not even the center of his own solar system. Man is just a speck of dust in time and space. And someday, alien civilizations may prove to man that this is the case. A drop of water on a plant can contain whole universes within it, as these photomicrographs show. Could not man's Earth be just a drop of water in the universe, and as easily brushed aside? Man's bold steps into the vastness of space are just the beginning of his understanding of the relative sizes of the universe. These life forms seem insignificant, alike, incapable of thought or any independent action. But can we afford to be so smug? Do these simple life forms hold the key to the mystery of life in the universe? We know that a few DNA molecules contain the very genetic fabric of life. And we know that even microscopic organisms can reproduce and survive, and that they will fight back when attacked. How sophisticated is the internal reasoning mechanism of these little creatures? Are they prototypes for the civilizations we might find in some distant galaxy? Who is to say that these tiny creatures are not capable of thought, reasoning, dreaming? Are they not every bit as placid as we are, encased in our world of supposed dominion over all creatures? Do they know of our existence? Probably not. These creatures cannot tell that we are observing them. But what about creatures who may be observing us? How can we tell that they are not watching us as coldly and dispassionately as we watch these supposedly elementary life forms through our microscope? Is it not possible that we are every bit as elementary to a foreign civilization as these little organisms are to us? These small beings continually devour each other to live. Is this not the way of the universe? Perhaps creatures from other planets might devour us to live. Who can say? How can we be sure? The answer is simple. We cannot. We cannot tell what civilizations watch us now, waiting for us to discover them. But what if they discover us? What is a second of their time is a million years of our time. Even now, they could be reaching across the black chasms of space and time, reaching for us. In friendship, or to assure our destruction? Only time will give us the answer. Time and space. For out there glimmering in the darkness is the future of man, or the end. Man must reconcile himself to the possibility of a visit from outer space, a visit the probability of which daily seems more likely. Reports of UFOs continue to pile up. The governments of the Earth seem engaged in a massive cover-up to keep the truth about UFOs from the public. What can we expect from out there in space? Do these small creatures give us a glimpse of our future, or even the future of the Earth, as it repopulates itself after an alien invasion? Our past and our future meet in outer space. These crystal life forms rapidly duplicate themselves, and in the space of a few seconds, they double in size and change shape dramatically. What sort of life form might exist on a very, very cold planet, such as Pluto? Is it not possible that crystal life forms might exist on some distant planet? Life forms that did not even need spaceships to travel from planet to planet. Life forms that could project themselves at will anywhere in the universe. These life forms could easily withstand the incredible cold of deep space. Another example of a life form adapting itself to the conditions in which it must survive. Can man survive as easily, or as well, in the face of an alien invasion? If aliens can come to the Earth from another planet, then our weapons would be of no use to us. Our atom bombs would be pop guns. Our most advanced surface-to-air missiles easily deflectable by force fields. With a UFO attack, there would be no place to run to, nowhere to hide. Will the Earth someday be a barren wasteland like this? Will Earth's civilization perish into the dust to be lost forever, as the lost civilizations of Atlantis? Will the Earth's contribution in the end amount to nothing more than a memory of an alien invading army? We cannot be sure that this will not come to pass. We have seen too many governments, too many civilizations topple and be completely forgotten, except to the recorded histories of later ruling classes. Is this to be our fate? Stranger, more mysterious things have happened. The sun could shine down on our planet and see nothing but ruins, dust, and decay as we are herded off to feed or serve some impassive alien monsters from outer space. Here, one of our ships approaches the Red Planet. This is a discovery satellite whose purpose is merely to gather information. The ship slowly circles the planet, searching for life forms and taking additional data which will help us to better understand Mars in the wake of the extraordinary mariner photographs of the surface of the planet. On Mars, the winds howl over the eternal desert of the planet, ominously wailing through the caverns over the vast expanses of open plain, whipping and whirling about the surface of the planet. Will Mars serve as the first landing post for an alien civilization, planning Earth's invasion? It could happen, and the secrets of Mars wait for man to uncover them. If alien civilizations did land on Earth, they would need extraordinary precise landing locations. Scout ships, many of which have been sighted through the years in countless reported UFO sightings, these scout ships would undoubtedly need to duplicate something like our own landing system, here demonstrated in a training prototype in NASA laboratories. Possibly some kind of automatic landing system could be used, where the ship is guided in by a tractor beam. Is this how the landing strips of Earth will look through an alien scanner as it touches down on our planet? Man continues to reach for the stars, for Mars, for the worlds beyond. One wonders what we are unlocking. Could some deadly virus from outer space destroy the Earth, inadvertently brought back by some of our own scout parties? Perhaps a virus which cannot even be detected by our instrumentation. Mariner took various soil samples on Mars with the aid of the robot arm you see here, which can be trained to do a variety of things at long-range distance. The soil samples were then analyzed within the probe and relayed as radio information back to computers on Earth. Here, the robot arm created by NASA is put to a more frivolous use. A human plays chess via the robot arm with another human opponent. Of course, the man is making all the decisions for the robot arm, and the robot arm merely carries out his wishes. But suppose the robot had a life of its own and were hooked up to a computer which operated it. The robot could play chess or pilot a spaceship from another planet. Out in space, this sentinel is watching, waiting for a sign. The first sign of invasion? The first sign of a friendly visit from outer space? Who knows? As man continues to explore the universe, the answer lies in the future. Struggles to understand the universe, inventing equations to map the distances in space, attempting to discover the secrets of the atom, trying to solve the question of his own place in the universe. Here at NASA laboratories, scientists engage in advanced research to determine the origins of our planet, sending up radio reconnaissance satellites to tell us more about our world and the universe around it. At the same time, we are aware that this information could be used to help defend the Earth in case of an attack from outer space. If one imagines the universe as a sort of celestial shooting gallery, one can rapidly see that the Earth is a very easy target. Even a chance shot might result in the Earth's destruction. Let this cannon represent an alien spacecraft spinning in space. By carefully charting the trajectory of the missile from the spaceship, alien invaders could calculate just the right angle and degree of spin for a direct hit on our home planet. Just one shot and oblivion. Of course, these reconnaissance satellites are currently used primarily for map-making throughout the universe. But our scientists are all too aware that these same principles of map-making could allow an alien civilization to draw a fatal bead on us. The precise degree to which we can map the terrain of a distant planet is a disturbing reminder of how easy it would be for an alien civilization to map our planet, as it may already be doing through the use of UFO scout ships piloted either by alien hands or by robots constructed by the aliens for this purpose. Many UFO sightings take place near military bases, missile installations, and other security and defense areas. Could it not be that alien civilizations are even now compiling maps which will assist them in the invasion of our planet? It is something we cannot be sure of. And so our scientists keep searching the skies, searching for evidence that we are not alone. As we travel through the silent black void of space, we are struck by the enormous distances between these giant neighbors of ours, these huge planets spinning silently in the illimitable reaches of the universe. Out here alone in the void of space, we have no way to tell where they are, which direction to travel in, as our ship glides silently past the planets. On Earth, scientists continually update the materials which we have on our celestial cousins. Precision machinery, honed to the smallest degree of tolerance, keeps watch on our solar system and the universe beyond. Sensitive seismographic devices churn out permanent records of the slightest vibration in the solar system. These calculations, coupled with the data sent back by our powerful radio telescopes, allow man to plan the course of his manned spacecrafts. All of this work leads up to one thing. Finally, man's quest into space. Here the rocket is finally readied and deployed from the hangar, headed for the launching pad, and the last-minute preparations have been completed. There's the first blast of the rockets, and we have liftoff. Streaking through the heavens, our first stage falls away. Alone in space, traveling at incredible speeds, we start on our journey across the stars to discover what? What will we find? What will we see as we travel through the stars, through the far-flung corners of the universe? What would another solar system look like, with planets unlike our own and a world completely undreamed of by man's imagination? What sort of order would such an alternate universe have? What strange creatures might live there? What kind of atmosphere would it have? Would it be a desert or a verdant meadow? Mountainous or flat plain? How many suns would the planet have? What would the cycles of the sun and moon be? How many alternate universes might there be, really? Outside the boundaries of our own small group of planets, there is a world completely unknown, which is waiting to be explored. Travel with us, then, as we rocket through the stars. We know only a few of the secrets of the universe, and we want to know more. Why must we wait? Why not now? Dawn on another world, a dawn so incredibly hot, we cannot stand the enormous blast of hot air pushing down upon us. We are on a planet which swings dangerously close to its sun, where the life forms need intense heat in order to survive. They thrive under these conditions, but without our protective suits, we would be burned to a cinder. In fact, no spacesuit exists at this point which could possibly withstand such searing temperatures. Another planet we pass is covered with a poison ring of gas. This red, desolate planet, very much like our own Mars, appears forbidding as we pass by. There, that pinpoint of light in the distance, it's the next galaxy we will visit. Far away in the distance, many, many millions of light years from our ship. But we will travel the distance in a few seconds. We see a small planet exploding in front of our eyes, and then sucked back into the blackness of interstellar space. This is the center of our fictional galaxy, and all the other planets in the solar system we are visiting revolve around this axis. But we must move on to the next planet on our voyage. And putting our ship in warp drive, we rocket away from this mysterious planet in the distant, unexplored vastness of our universe. From our new vantage point out in space, the huge planet is left behind, a small speck in the distance. Vapor trails from our rocket ship vanish off into the black vastness of interstellar space as we move on to the next destination in our tour of this alien universe. We are traveling forward now to our final stop on this amazing journey. This is a planet of gases connected to a sister planet by an umbilical cord of poison gas and noxious fumes. From the depths of outer space, we return to Earth. Here is the notorious magician Edward Kelly raising a ghost with his assistant. Kelly, one of the most infamous of the black magicians of Europe, practiced in the late 1800s. Here is psychic detective Peter Herko in the room where Sharon Tate was killed in the infamous Manson murders. Herko hopes that the psychic vibrations of the room will give him a key to the killer. Here we see a more scientific method of vibrational divination. This 20th century divining rod uses different elements to aid in the search for water, precious minerals, and other natural resources. Here we have a curious case of a child abducted by a UFO. We see the mothership hovering over the Earth. The child is lifted away from the Earth to the spaceship. Here we see an actual photograph of a ghost materializing right before the camera. This picture was taken in the late 1880s as part of a seance conducted by the psychic shown here, whose name is lost to us. This house is reputed to be haunted. It is said that no one can stay overnight in this house and live. The house has been rented many times, but none of the tenants stay. It is in upstate New York. Here we see the poet Dante with his immortal Divine Comedy, showing the various stations of heaven and hell. Dante's vision of the world beyond captured the imagination of an entire century. It is still controversial today. The statue of Buddha in Kamakura, Japan. This statue symbolizes the teachings of Buddha, who said that man could only attain enlightenment by renouncing all material desires. This young Buddhist monk is the incarnate Lama, or the reincarnation of a deceased Buddhist priest. The Dalai Lama, Tibet's supreme religious leader, is also predestined in this fashion. The face shown at the right of the screen is that of Katie King, as materialized by the spirit medium Florence Cook. This photograph was taken by the distinguished British metaphysician Sir William Crookes. On the right in this photograph is the fingerprint of a ghost. This impression was made in dental wax as part of a seance in 1911 under the closest scrutiny of doctors and police. This dead kettle leaf photographed by the famed Kirlian method is surrounded by the life force which seeps from it. This life force surrounds every living object in the universe. These spirit photographs were the work of Thomas Hudson, the first British psychic photographer. Hudson was eventually discovered to be a fraud. Sometimes he even dressed up as the ghost himself in order to please his rich clients. Fakery such as this gave mediums a bad name. It prompted Houdini to embark upon his famous campaign to discover an honest medium. These are Kirlian photographs of a man's finger, shown with the emanating life force completely surrounding the outstretched thumb. This subject has taken a drug to make the corona surrounding the finger more noticeable. This is a psychic healer from the Philippines in the process of treating a young patient. Witch doctors such as these often perform merely temporary cures. Their patients often die after a psychic operation. This is the British psychic healer Harry Edwards attempting to cure one of his followers of back trouble. By keeping his energy attuned to his invisible spirit guides, Edwards directs the healing energy specifically to the patient. One of history's most infamous madmen was the notorious Adolf Hitler, shown here at his mountain playground near Berchtesgaden. Hitler spared no expense to surround himself with luxuries as his countrymen starved. Here we see Hitler surrounded by little German children. Meanwhile, the concentration camps of Hitler's horrible war machine operated day by day. We show you here rare footage taken by Hitler's mistress, Eva Braun, with a 16mm camera and experimental color film shortly before 1939. At this point, Hitler was still winning the war, and his spirits were generally high. A few years later, just before the collapse of the Third Reich, he would be a hollow-eyed man of shattered dreams who lived from day to day on a diet of strong coffee and stimulant drugs, although he prided himself on being a vegetarian. Hitler's despotic regime destroyed Germany, but Hitler did not care about that. No expense was spared to bring the best entertainment, the best food, the finest wines, the best cigars and furniture to Hitler's sumptuous mountain retreat while the rest of Germany starved. Hitler was lost in his own private dream, nestled in his dream house high in the mountains. Life was a never-ending series of parties, which became increasingly decadent as the war drew to its inevitable catastrophic conclusion. Hitler would make judgments of incredible stupidity for a major military leader. He ignored the advice of his closest aides and consultants and depended heavily on astrology to guide his progress in battle. An incredible succession of fortune tellers came to Berchtesgaden, each with their own advice for the crazed German ruler. Hitler listened to them all, often contradicting himself from one day to the next. When Hitler made a decision, no matter how capricious or insane it might have seemed to his associates, he went ahead with it in the face of overwhelming disapproval from his own staff of generals. Many people have agreed that Hitler's ridiculous handling of the affairs of battle towards the end of the war, during his most insane period, played directly into the hands of the Allies and brought the fighting to a mercifully quicker end. The bucolic countryside gave the awesome mansion an air of gentility, even old-world feudal charm. Beautiful peasant girls roamed Hitler's mountain estate, picking flowers to grace the dictator's tables. No one dared to refuse the Führer's wishes, and those who refused to work for minimal pay often mysteriously disappeared overnight without a trace. The atmosphere in these home movies is deceiving. No one here is relaxed. None are really enjoying themselves. They are trying to forget the war, trying to forget that a madman is in charge of their destinies. And they wait out their final hours in the twilight of Hitler's Germany with a drink in one hand and a cigarette in the other. These are the decadent rulers of the fabled master race. Here, Hitler harangues his staff, threatening them with deportation and disappearance if they fail in carrying out his orders. In all the footage we saw of Hitler, he is never more animated than here, guiding the progress of his holy war. At this point, many of the generals shown in this footage were already secretly planning to assassinate Hitler. And Hitler escaped the attempted murder plot by the merest stroke of luck. Six of the generals involved in the plot were later tortured and executed as punishment for their disloyalty to their Führer. Here we see the glamour girls of Hitler's Germany. A typical day at Berchtesgaden garden would consist of swimming, then picnics, then drinks, and lounging in easy chairs high atop the mountains surrounding Hitler's palatial estate. And then dancing and dining in the evening. Hitler was a great physical fitness enthusiast, although he refused to have his picture taken ever out of uniform. Eva Braun, as we can see from this footage, was not as modest. Hitler's generals all had girlfriends who frolicked with them under the very noses of their wives, who dared not complain lest they be banished from the select circle of the inner chosen few. These outings would go on endlessly, idyllically, for there was really no reason for them ever to end. There was plenty of money, and time seemed to have no meaning for these golden gods of the Third Reich. Hitler himself stayed removed from most of the merrymaking, content to harangue his generals as they hurried about, trying their best to save the war for a leader who seemed determined to lose it. Hitler was also a firm believer in the prophecies of Nostradamus, the ancient mystic whose amazingly accurate predictions prophesied the beginning of World War II, the deaths of several popes, and major wars and cataclysms throughout the world's history. Hitler believed that Nostradamus's prophecies guaranteed him perpetual, unconditional victory. And in the belief that the war would be won by Germany no matter what he did, Hitler attended to the duties of administering to his troops with the most careless abandon. Towards the end of the war in 1945, Berlin was actually being defended by groups of school children, many of whom were no older than 11 or 12. The children were sacrificed senselessly so that Hitler might obtain a little more time to hold on to his insane dream of power. Here, nestled among the pine trees of Germany, the war seemed remote and far away. No one could hear the cannons booming, the sounds of millions of innocent people dying. Hitler's mountain retreat was a place of endless fantasy, and Hitler believed that the party would never end. Often released their frustrations in juvenile horseplay, as in this rare footage showing Hitler's staff and their wives splashing about in the mountain lakes which dotted the surrounding region. While every care and want was attended to, there was an air of unrelenting boredom that hung over Hitler's dream paradise. One often felt like a prisoner in a gilded cage, where attendance at dinners and parties was mandatory, and gossip and innuendo ruled the inner chambers of the Führer's seat of power. Hitler knew everything that went on in his mountain hideout. His insane assistant, Dr. Joseph Goebbels, the Nazi minister of propaganda, would report daily to Hitler on every bit of the latest gossip of Berchtesgaden. But on the surface, all was peace and tranquility and endless frolic and games. Life in Berchtesgaden was quiet, relaxing, restful. There was very little work for anyone to do. All the wishes of the guests were attended to by servants who staffed the houses of Hitler's mountain hideaway. Cooks, chambermaids, hundreds of other minor functionaries all attended to the slightest whim of the crazed dictator and his friends. It seemed as if no one could save Germany from the rule of this iron-fisted madman. Hitler loved to surround himself with beautiful women, to take his mind off the cares of war and the rapidly growing realization that Germany must inevitably lose in the final outcome. No one could guess that in a short time, all the dreams of Hitler's Germany would lie at their feet in ashes, and Hitler himself would lie dead, sprawled on the sofa in his bunker, having shot himself in the last days of 1945. For the present, all was peace and quiet. But Hitler's madman dreams were coming to a horrifying, incredible end. Who could foretell the events which were to rip Germany asunder in the final days of the war? Those final days which would end in bloodshed, destruction, and the complete annihilation of a civilization. Hitler's Gestapo had almost unlimited power, and one had to go along with their idea of good times or else. One might think this is just harmless horseplay, but a more sinister element undoubtedly lurks behind these seemingly untroubled images. Often in Berchtesgaden, there was little to do other than to sit on the dock watching the ships go by from the outside world. The rulers of the new Germany grew bored, and they wanted to escape. Water skiers dotted the lakes and rivers each day, but each boat was carefully checked out and watched by SS patrol boats from the shore. If a boat did not return before nightfall, the SS would swing into action and often pick up the defecting guests as they were attempting to cross over the border into Switzerland in safety. Outrageous acrobatics were the order of the day, and the guests would vie among themselves to provide good footage for Eva Braun's camera. This footage was flown to Berlin and processed at great expense, and then rushed back to be shown the next day at one of Hitler's after-dinner gatherings. Hitler would often applaud a particularly funny bit of footage. Behind these seemingly innocent woods, Hitler's SS established a dumping ground for the bodies of Hitler's hapless victims. This looks like a beautiful countryside scene in autumn, but in fact, the daily horror of those who lived with Hitler overshadowed any scenic beauty and made the lives of those imprisoned at Berchtesgaden an unending nightmare of unspeakable horror. Often when he was bored, Hitler would amuse himself by running home movies when his guests were not about. This particularly frivolous footage shows the degree to which Hitler completely ignored the realities of his collapsing master race, of how he lived in a world of fantasy inside the walls of his sumptuous prison. Often fun and games became mindless cruelty, as Hitler would not dare to intervene in the affairs of the SS. These fanatic protectors of the Reich would roam the grounds of Hitler's estate looking for even the most minor infraction of Hitler's incredibly strict rules. Guests were often humiliated in front of other guests, and one could never know when Hitler would suddenly stage a crackdown and send waves of SS guards goose-stepping through all the private chambers of the immense mansion in a paranoid attempt to sniff out supposed treachery. Hitler remained convinced that treachery was a continual threat to his very existence. As the battle tide began to turn against him, Hitler became increasingly reclusive, staying inside almost all the time, speaking to no one but a few top generals, and then only to scream at them that their incompetence was costing him the war. One cannot help but wonder what thoughts tumbled through Hitler's madman mind as the inevitable day of destruction approached him. Hitler postponed his long overdue day of reckoning for as long as possible, often diverting much-needed men and material from frontline duty in order to construct elaborate pageants for his associates. Here we see Hitler preparing for a banquet ceremony. As was his custom, he is seated first after the room has been carefully searched for bombs. Hitler looks tired, even in this footage taken in 1940, 5 years before the collapse of the Nazi tyranny. Going outside, Hitler would insist on dressing in full military uniform. Hitler's Germany was a culture of the body, a culture of extreme narcissism and useless idolatry. Laziness was excused on the grounds that the men and women of Hitler's master race were too good to work and that their time was too valuable to be wasted in mundane chores which any mere peasant could perform. With nothing to do, endless exercise and health fadism became the rage. The elders of the ruling class struggled to compete in the bodybuilding sweepstakes with younger SS officers. The endless preening, the needless posturing of the Third Reich is reminiscent of bored adolescents attempting to play soldier with little effect. Unhappily, Hitler's military might brought Europe to its knees, and in his insanity, Hitler sought to take Germany with him when his crazed dream collapsed. Hitler would take with him several SS guards on his walks around his estate as he formulated policy while consulting the astrological prognostications of a host of cynical, unreliable contemporary German mystics. Even at the end, Hitler felt that the teachings of Nostradamus showed that Germany could not survive without him. Accordingly, Hitler made plans for the complete destruction of Germany at the time of his death. These plans were never carried out because the Allies reached Berlin shortly after Hitler's suicide. But for Adolf Hitler, reality had long ago ceased to exist. Hitler lived in a twilight world of insane dreams of power, of tarot decks and fortune tellers, of palm readings and tea leaf divination. Hitler's reliance on such unreliable methods of forecasting increased as his plight became critical, and his aides gave up trying to reason with him. Hitler believed only in fortune tellers, gypsies, and in the portents of the astrological tables as interpreted by his personal astrologer, who never left Hitler's side. Hitler's last days were indeed the insane culmination of a lifelong flight from reality into an incredible fantasy that ended in death and destruction for an entire continent. Visions of history's most infamous dictator, we move back into space for a trip through space and time, a voyage of discovery in outer space. We have left our own planet, and we are traveling among the stars in search of an alien civilization. What will we find? What will we see in this galaxy so much like and yet very unlike our own? Gliding past the planets, we discover an alien listening post far from our own Earth, where an alien civilization listens in on our radio broadcasts in an attempt to monitor the Earth's progress in the race for the stars. Are these aliens friendly, or are they bent on using this information against us? In this fictional galaxy of a faraway corner of the universe, we can imagine the most incredible civilizations that deep space can give us. These listening radar posts are the outposts of an alien civilization, which may or may not be a force in our future. Mankind searches through the stars, looking for some clue that he is not alone. The illimitable dominion of vast interstellar space dawns before him, and man realizes that he can know but a small portion of the mysteries of outer space. This is Aleister Crowley, degenerate, drug addict, black magic practitioner, and Satanist. Crowley led a cult of devil worshippers in the U.S. and England for over 40 years before his death. This is the mummified corpse of Ramses II, ruler of Egypt, who lived and died around 1220 B.C. Ramses' corpse is astonishingly well-preserved in view of its extreme age. Here, a modern Satanist ceremony culminates in a ritual sacrifice. Satanist ceremonies are held in secret to avoid persecution by the police and other authorities. There are thousands of devil worshippers in the U.S. today. Here we see St. George slaying the dragon. This popular legend persisted throughout Europe from the Middle Ages forward. Did George really slay the dragon? We will never really know. Here a group of Africans perform a native ceremony, praying to their gods for rain for their parched crops. The ceremony will last for days, or until rain comes to their dying land. Nuba wrestlers cover themselves in ashes, symbol of rejuvenation and new life. These wrestlers of Africa often fight to the death as part of a religious ceremony. These Samburu women of Africa are dancing to induce a trance-like state so that they may better communicate with their gods. This trance-like state is held for as long as possible, leaving the worshipper exhausted after coming out of the spell of the dance. Contemporary Americans have many beliefs about life after death. Is the grave the end of man, or is there life after death? This controversy, argued by Houdini and Conan Doyle, among others, will probably never be solved. Here we have a medieval monarch supposedly drawn through the air by a flock of griffins. This sort of myth persisted throughout most of the 12th and 13th centuries. This is the religious dance of the Algonquin Indians. The rattles and corn the celebrants hold are Indian symbols of fertility. This Indian child, celebrating the festival of Shiva, is covered in ashes, believed to have the power to cure many illnesses. Such beliefs are common throughout India. Here we see the infant Jesus being held by Mary shortly after the first Christmas. This stone frieze depicts the creation of the sun and the moon in Christian teachings. This is a detail from the Salisbury Cathedral in England. Adam and Eve are expelled from the Garden of Eden in this detail from the 11th century chapel doors at St. Zeno's Basilica, Verona. Abel and Melchizedek make their offerings to Jehovah in this ancient mosaic. There is a striking similarity in many religious traditions throughout the world, and often there are parallel stories to those in the Bible found in other religions. In this old painting, we see Abraham with the three angels. What is the fact behind so much biblical legend? Do angels actually exist? The questions raised by modern theologians are still unresolved. These figures carved in the 13th century represent the predecessors of Jesus in ancient times. These men later lived to be witnesses to many miracles, according to the Bible. Here we see Mary and the angel Gabriel in one of Mary's visitations from heaven. The Bible is full of many such incidents, and scientists and religious teachers alike search for more information to substantiate these incidents. Here we see Jonah in the body of the whale. One of the most famous Bible stories, the story of Jonah and the whale has been verified as quite true by many modern researchers. Here we see the first of Jesus' many visitations in the desert. The devil tempts him, but it is to no avail. Theologians today struggle with the question of the devil's existence. In an example of humility, Jesus washes the feet of the disciples. In spite of the many miracles in the Bible, the human touch is continually present. The most amazing of biblical miracles is probably the resurrection of Jesus. This is celebrated as Easter and remains one of the great mysteries of the Bible. Here we see a visitation by angels to the disciples as shown on the ceiling of the Chartres Cathedral, France. The technique of this painting is a miracle unto itself. These devils, dragons, and monsters figure prominently in the Bible. Many of these biblical stories have been proven to be completely accurate, and the tales of biblical miracles continue to confound the most ardent skeptics. From ancient miracles, we turn to the modern miracle of spaceflight. Here in the NASA laboratories, we see the training of a pilot for a flight into deep space. These simple machines conceal a wealth of sophisticated machinery which the pilot must master if he is to successfully navigate deep space. One false move, one error in judgment, and the pilot could be hopelessly lost in space, completely unable to return to Earth. The fuel supply aboard rockets is always critical. And with so little margin for error, Absolute accuracy in all judgments is essential. These pilots undergo many grueling hours of testing and training in order to ready them for a flight to another planet. Instructions are punched into the ship's computer by the use of a control panel, which resembles a telephone touch dial. But these instructions control the life or death decisions which the pilot must make in order to survive in deep space. These test runs will later be duplicated in reality. And then the pilot's training will be all important if he is to reach the moon safely with his ship. The pilot weighs each decision as critically as if he were actually in flight. The test chamber becomes a real spacecraft, speeding across space. Inside his ship, the pilot is safe from the dangers of space only so long as he can successfully maneuver his craft through the asteroid belts, meteors, and other hazards of deep space. The decisions are all split second. Timing is of the utmost importance. The ship's computer relays back his instructions to the pilot, who then rechecks them to make certain that they are accurate. In addition, the pilot has a backup computer within the ship, which automatically recalculates all his course corrections so that there is no possibility of an error or malfunction. Using the toggle switch to control his retro rockets, the pilot steers his course, correcting the flight path ever so slightly as he heads for the moon. The moon swings into view in his ship's periscope. He lines up the target site with the moon. These calculations are critical. He must accurately land in a non-mountainous area, just as if he were landing on Earth. Now he lines up his ship with the moon's path. And as we see from the little dot on the right, the pilot has correctly guided his rocket so that the flight will be successful. But there is no time to relax. Out there in space, there are 1,001 hazards to watch out for. And the computer keeps informing the pilot of the rapidly changing conditions which surround the ship. In this maze of calculated and recalculated numbers, the pilot feels as if he cannot possibly do all of this at once. Even with the ship's two computers to help him, his decisions must continue at a rapid pace. As the ship speeds toward the silent planet, he makes a few final corrections, which the rockets perform perfectly. Even with the enormous pressure, both man and machine are functioning perfectly. And now, the final thrust to the moon and beyond. Now, with all the long preparation, we approach the moon, the silent sentinel in our heavens. What mysteries will we find on the moon as we look through our periscope at the barren surface? What mysteries does it hold for us? Will we find life on the moon? Will alien civilizations use the moon for a possible launching pad or a future alien invasion? This question joins the many unanswered questions in the astounding world of deep space and extraterrestrial phenomena. And so, we approach the end of our journey, a journey of contrasts and contradictions, a voyage through a world of space, time, and illimitable distances. The mysteries of space are only now beginning to unfold. And as we search across the heavens for a closer view, we cannot help but speculate on what our future will be as children of the universe. Who will visit us, coming across the millions of light years to be our neighbors among the stars? What amazing secrets will we learn in the coming years as man expands his already amazing mastery further and further into the reaches of the universe? Man's knowledge of the planets is just beginning, and beyond our solar system lie new worlds waiting to be explored. Will we discover life on other planets, or will life on other planets discover us first? What will we do when faced by the threat of an alien invasion from outer space? What will we do when the flying saucers attack the Earth? It seems that more than ever, we need an ally in the vast domain of outer space. And somewhere out there, we might have friends with whom we could explore the universe together. But all of this is in the realm of science fantasy, not science fact. Each new day brings its own mysteries. Each day ends with another new mystery solved. What surprises are there in store for us as we continually challenge the very secrets of life in the universe itself? As we roam across the vast reaches of space, searching for answers, as did the ancients who searched the skies and dreamed of flight, we consider that man is but a small part in the incredible vastness of the universe. Man's ancient instruments of navigation and space navigation have given way to more complex technologies. But man's quest to unravel the mysteries of the stars remains unchanged. Man has reached the moon, but where do we go from there? Man's unceasing search for knowledge will never end until he has solved the last riddle in the amazing world of mysteries.